Good morning. Welcome to the Lord's house. It is so good to see all of you, and it is good for us to gather in God's house to hear his word and to learn and grow in our faith in Jesus. So good morning and welcome to all of you. A number of announcements. The first one is some good news for right now. We've run out of bulletins. So if anybody can share bulletins, I'm going to ask the ushers to come down, and if you can just collect maybe a dozen or so, and some people coming in who don't have a bulletin can get a bulletin, all right? A number of announcements. There's an insert in your bulletin. On one side is the cookie order, so if you'd like to order cookies from the cookie walk, you can do that. On the other side has a whole bunch of information about upcoming events. Our midweek services start this Wednesday. 1 and 7 this Wednesday and next Wednesday. And prior to the early service, prior to the 1 o'clock service, the Ladies League will be serving soup and bread and desserts. So if you want to come for that. 50 plus luncheon is this Friday. There's a sign-up sheet back there. Christmas caroling will be 1 week from today in the afternoon. So if you're interested in that, I think there's a sign-up for that as well. The school band concert will be a week from Tuesday. So that's coming up not this week, but next week. The children's service will be Wednesday the 20th at both services, 1 o'clock and 7 o'clock. We have a bulletin up there?
No, I forgot to ask you to thank all the gentlemen that helped yesterday with leaves.
Okay.
Along with their blowers.
Thank you to all of you who helped yesterday with blowers and rakes to clean up the property. I did notice on the way in, even though it was dark, and I saw all the leaves were gone or ground up or pushed into the ravine. So that was wonderful. So thank you to all of you who helped with that as well. Something else to note on this side of the handout as well, on Christmas Eve, our services. Since Christmas Eve this year falls on a Sunday, in our morning Sunday morning services, we'll only have one service at 9:30. And then on Christmas Eve evening, we'll have our regular two services at 4 and 6. Services of lessons and carols. And then a few other things just to mention as well. The Ladies League is supporting a seminarian, Matthew Mockimer. If you'd like to make a donation, there's a basket in the back. Also, if you'd like to write out some cards for some of our shut-ins, they always appreciate getting a bunch of cards. There's a basket in the back also with packets of cards that you can write to the shut-ins, and then the Ladies League will deliver them. So keep that in mind. Ladies League brunch, Advent brunch, is coming up this coming Saturday. Also, it's not in the bulletin, but our new circuit-wide youth group called Koinonia, they're having their second event this afternoon. It's from 5 till 7. They're meeting at Trinity St. Joe. There's a flyer taped to the door. I put that up there. So spread the word, and their activity for this particular event is they're going to play a live version of the classic game, Clue. So spread the word to high school kids for that. And then really last two things, wow, poinsettia orders. If you'd like to order poinsettias, it's right there inside the bulletin. Fill that out. I don't know if there's a box back there, but you can just turn it into the church office. And then the last thing is the current version of the Christ Times is out. Brand new, hot off the presses. Some of you get it via email, or there are hard copies back there. Wow. It is a busy time of the year. In this Advent season, which we begin today, as we begin to prepare for the coming of our Savior Jesus. He came once and he will come again. What a wonderful time of year it is, a brand new church year. Again, welcome to all of you. We begin with our opening hymn.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Let us then confess our sins to God our Father.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we have lit the first candle on our Advent wreath, we confess that Jesus, the wondrous child, is also the light divine who came forth from the Father, conceived by the Holy Spirit, and born of the Virgin Mary, as the prophet Isaiah long ago foretold. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. The Advent of our King. Our prayers must now employ, and we must hymns of welcome sing in strains of holy joy. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
comfort and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Stir up your power, O Lord, and come, that by your protection we may be rescued from the threatening perils of our sins and saved by your mighty deliverance. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Reading from the Book of Concord, the Augsburg Confession, Article 3, the Son of God. Our churches teach that the Word, that is, the Son of God, assumed the human nature in the womb of the Blessed Virgin Mary. So, there are two natures, the divine and the human, inseparably joined in one person. There is one Christ, true God and true man, who was born of the Virgin Mary, truly suffered, was crucified, died, and was buried. He did this to reconcile to the Father to us, and to be a sacrifice, not only for original guilt, but also for all actual sins of mankind. He also descended into hell and truly rose again on the third day. Afterward, he ascended into heaven to sit at the right hand of the Father. There, he forever reigns and has dominion over all creatures. He sanctifies those who believe in him by sending the Holy Spirit into their hearts to rule, comfort, and make them alive. He defends them against the devil and the power of sin. The same Christ will openly come again to judge the living and the dead and so forth, according to the Apostles' Creed.
On this first Sunday of Advent, the beginning of a new church year, our Old Testament lesson is from Isaiah chapter 64. Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down, that the mountains might quake at your presence, and when fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, and that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome things that we did not look for, you came down. The mountains quaked at your presence. From of old, no one has heard or perceived by the ear. No eye has seen a God besides you who acts for those who wait for him. You meet him who joyfully works righteousness, those who remember you in your ways. Behold, you were angry, and we sinned. In our sins, we have been a long time. And shall we be saved? We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a polluted garment. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls upon your name, who rouses himself to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us, and have made us melt in the hand of our iniquities. But now, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. Be not so terribly angry, O Lord, and remember not iniquity forever. Behold, please look, we are all your people. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our epistle lesson this morning is from 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you because of the grace of God that was given you in Christ Jesus, that in every way you were enriched in him in all speech and in all knowledge, even as the testimony about Christ was confirmed among you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift, as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ, who will sustain you to the end, guiltless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, by whom you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Gospel according to St. Mark, the 13th chapter. Glory to you, Lord. Jesus said, In those days, after that tribulation, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. And then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. And then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts out its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near, at the very gates. Truly, I say to you, this generation will not pass away until all these things take place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But concerning that day or that hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. Be on guard, keep awake, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey, when he leaves home and puts his servants in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to stay awake. Therefore, stay awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or when the cock crows, or in the morning, lest he come suddenly and find you asleep. And what I say to you, I say to all, stay awake. This is the gospel of the Lord. Sometimes we have to wait for things, right? Like waiting for Pastor to start talking. Yeah, exactly. Sometimes when we wait for things, we might be a little nervous or anxious about whatever we're waiting for, or sometimes we might be excited about what we're waiting for, and sometimes it's hard to wait. Sometimes we just wish it would happen right now. We just wish that whatever we're waiting for would come because we don't want to wait anymore. Well, guess what? We are all waiting for something. The end of this month. What are we waiting for? Yes. You knew the answer, right? Christmas. Yes. Christmas. We're waiting for Christmas. How wonderful. Are you guys excited about Christmas? Yeah. Do you wish it were here right now? Yeah. No. Yes. I think many of us wish it were here right now. It would be wonderful. It's an exciting time of year. But sometimes it's hard to wait. So something that can help us when we're waiting for something and it's hard to wait, something that we can do is prepare. That's a kind of a big word maybe, but that means to get ready. If you're spending your time getting ready for something, then that helps use up your time and it helps keep you busy so you don't get so frustrated that you have to wait, all right? So we try to prepare and get ready. What kinds of things do you do to get ready for Christmas? Okay, put up your Christmas tree. Good. Decorate the house, yes. Play in the snow, absolutely. That's important. Decorate your tree, yes. Give cards to people, all right, very good. Absolutely, all those sorts of things. All right, last one. Get milk and cookies, okay. Gotta have cookies, absolutely. Do you make cookies? Yeah, it's fun making cookies, isn't it? Now, all of those things to prepare helps us to get ready for Christmas, even though we have to wait for Christmas, and sometimes it's hard to wait. But I want to point out something for you. All of those things help us get ready to celebrate Christmas, and that's a good thing. But Christmas isn't primarily about us celebrating, is it? What's the most important thing about Christmas? It's not Christmas parties. It's not opening presents, although that's fun to do. It's not decorating the tree. What's the most important thing about Christmas? Jesus' birthday. Absolutely. We celebrate Jesus' birthday. And Jesus had to come because we need help as a savior. We need a savior, right? So one of the things we can do while we wait for Jesus is also we can say in our prayers and we can think about it in church and we say, Jesus, I know I need help. I've done some bad things. I've sinned. That's the big word there. I've sinned and I need some help. So Jesus, please come and forgive me. And that prepares us to get ready for when Jesus came in his birthday. He came all the way back in time in his birthday and he's going to come again to take us all to heaven someday. So that's a wonderful thing too. So we prepare not only to celebrate Christmas, but we prepare ourselves to know that Jesus' birthday is coming, and that is a wonderful thing. He came as our Savior. He was born, lived, died, and rose again so that we are forgiven, and we know heaven with Jesus is the greatest gift of all that we get. All right? So when you have to wait, remember, something to help you while you're waiting is to prepare, to get ready for whatever it is you're waiting for. And that helps you in other things, but it also helps you in the church. All right, thank you guys for coming up. You can all have one of my lifesavers and head back to your seats. Thank you guys. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Please be seated. Well, God's people are a waiting people. Abraham waited for a son. The Hebrews waited for freedom from slavery. The exiles waited to return. The Israelites waited over and over again for prophecy to be fulfilled. They waited, and so do we. We wait for God's answers to our prayers. We wait for God's deliverance from our problems. We wait for salvation for ourselves and for others. We wait for the coming of the Messiah, who came once in time and will come yet again. Waiting. It's often not easy, but we wait. Now, if you're waiting for something and you already know when it's going to happen, even though you may not know what is going to happen, maybe the waiting is a little bit easier. Maybe, for instance, there's a football game you're looking forward to. You know when it's going to happen, but you may not know what will happen, what the outcome will be. So you wait for it, perhaps with some nervous anticipation, but at least you know when it will happen and how long your wait will be. Or the opposite of that. You know, perhaps, something in the future, what is going to happen, but you don't know when. You're waiting for something good. Perhaps you're waiting for a package to be delivered, or you're waiting for a baby to come. And so you know what is going to happen, but you don't know when, and so you wait for that with excitement. What if, however, you are waiting for something that is completely unknown? You don't know what it will be, and you don't know when it will happen. You're waiting for news from a soldier who's in war overseas. You're waiting for results from a medical test. Will the news be good or bad? When will I hear something? Is no news good news or is no news bad news? And so we wait with nervousness and anxiety. What if in a given situation you know the end result with certainty? I'm going to give you an illustration. There have been many times throughout my life where I have recorded a game to watch at a later point in time. My schedule didn't allow me to watch it live. And even though I try to avoid it, I end up sometimes hearing the result before you get to go back and watch the game. I'm sure this has happened to some of you. Now, if I end up hearing the result and my team lost, well, I don't bother watching the game. I don't really care. But if I hear that my team won, then I still watch the game with interest and curiosity to learn the details, to learn the good plays and the bad plays and who scored, etc. But there's none of that nervous tension because I already know the end result. Advent is like that. It is a time of waiting, but we already know the end result. During this season of Advent, we are waiting for two things. It's a time of waiting while we prepare to celebrate that our Savior has already come. He has come in the past. We know what happened. We know when it happened. God fulfilled His promise and sent His Son to you to be born in humble circumstances, to live, to die, and to rise again for you. And so we wait while we prepare to celebrate the past yet again. Advent is also a time of waiting with hope for the future. We have hope in the certain promise that our Savior will come again. Jesus promises that He will come a final time to take you home to Himself in eternal glory. So we already know the bookends. We know the details of the past, and we know the future, that our Savior will come again, even though we don't know when. And what happens in the meantime? In the meantime, we wait through the details of this earthly life. Yes, we know the outcome, but we don't know the details, do we? The details are indeed murky and mysterious for each of us. We don't know the penalties or fumbles, the problems or challenges that will confront us. Nor can we foresee the great plays or the scores, the joys and the blessings that we will receive throughout our lives. We know the end score, that we do know. The end score is you, eternity, Satan, zero. But we don't know the murky details of how we get there. Jesus did come in the past, and we know with certainty he will come in the future, but we don't know those details now. So for your benefit, even in the midst of this earthly life, with the murkiness of the details, Jesus also comes to you right now. Not just past, not just future. He comes to you right now in the present. Jesus is with you now. Paul says this in our epistle lesson. In every way you were enriched in him, in all speech and in all knowledge, as the testimony about Christ was confirmed among you, so that you are not lacking in any gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ, who will sustain you to the end. Jesus is with you right now, helping you, guiding you, protecting you, yes, admonishing you when you need it, comforting you, sustaining you. When you read the Bible, Jesus is with you. When you pray his words back to him, like we do in the Lord's Prayer, Jesus is with you. And most importantly, of course, he is with you right now, here in church. Jesus is with you. I want to have a little moment of side teaching to explain to you how Jesus is with you right now in church. I want to teach for a moment about the salutation in our church service. The salutation generally happens, depending on the order of service, one or two or three times in our church service. And the salutation is this. The pastor says, "The Lord be with you." Well, I didn't expect that, but that's great. That's excellent. Now, when the pastor says, "The Lord be with you," that's not a wish. That's not a desire. That's a proclamation of fact. It's a reality. And yes, it's kind of old English, so it sounds a bit strange, but the meaning is this: the Lord is with you right now. The Lord be with you. In other words, through the reading of God's word and through the proclamation of the gospel of Jesus, the Lord is with you right now. The Lord be with you. That's what it is. Then the original response from the congregation back in TLH, many of you will remember, "and with thy spirit." Now, what that meant was this: and with you, Pastor, with the extra measure of the Holy Spirit that is given to you in ordination, may that Holy Spirit be with you to empower you to preach God's word faithfully. It's true, yes, we all receive the Holy Spirit in the waters of baptism. But like Elisha, the pastor receives an extra measure of the Holy Spirit in ordination in order to faithfully proclaim God's word publicly. Luther called the salutation the little ordination. The pastor proclaims, "The Lord be with you." The Lord is with you right now. And the congregation would respond, "and with thy spirit," with the spirit given to you in your ordination, Pastor, that you may faithfully proclaim his word so that we know God is with us. One last little bit on this moment of teaching. "And with thy spirit." Yes, it's a bit old-fashioned English again. So at some point, there was an attempt made to modernize the phrase and also with you. Unfortunately, sometimes it's mistakenly viewed as merely a greeting. Oh, the Lord be with you, and also with you. But that's not the intent. And also with you still means the same thing as, and with thy spirit. The Lord be with you. Right now, God is with you. And the response, and also with you, means, and may the Lord continue to be with you, Pastor, to empower you to preach God's word to us. The whole point of this little moment of teaching is that God is with you right now. Through the reading and the proclamation of his word, God is with you. Yes, he's with you at other times as well, but for certain, he promises he is with you right now, right here in his building, in his church, in his house, from invocation to benediction. God is with you. Jesus is with you through his word and his sacraments. He is with you through his forgiveness of your sins. He is with you through comfort and encouragement for you, even in the midst of those murky details of each of our lives. So yes, it is true. We wait. We wait to celebrate Jesus' first coming. We wait for Jesus to come again that final time in glory. We wait through the unknown details, the murky, mysterious details of this earthly life, through the fumbles and the scores, through the problems and through the joys. We wait. Yes, sometimes with trepidation. We wait. We are God's people, and we wait for him. So be patient. Have comfort. Dwell in peace, the peace of God, and embrace the hope of your eternity in glory. Because it's just as Isaiah says in our Old Testament lesson, no eye has seen a God besides him who acts for those who wait for him. Thanks be to God. In Jesus' name, amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, guard and keep your hearts and your minds in the one true faith in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. We now join together in unity, publicly confessing our faith using the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty.
Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, sustain your saints to the end as we enter another church year. Encourage the preachers of your word and all those who hear that the testimony about Christ may be confirmed among us as we wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give boldness and faithfulness to Matthew, our synodical president, David, our district president, Michael, our circuit visitor, and all pastors in Christ. We pray for your guidance and blessing also upon all your church workers, including our principal and our teachers, and upon our missionaries, including Reverend Carlos Schumann and Deaconess Danielle Schumann in the Dominican Republic, and Deaconess Caitlin Warden de Ramirez in Peru. Renew the faith and quicken the love of all Christians, that we may be enriched in all speech and in all knowledge of your Son. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, grant your blessing to all marriages and keep all husbands and wives faithful to each other. Guide them as they care for the children entrusted to them. Bestow your loving care upon all your people, especially those who are suffering in any way. We pray for your blessing and your strength and your patience for all your people, for all of our members, for all those gathered here today. And especially this day, we pray for Wayne and Cora Herman, Naomi Hedig, Eleanor Hoagie, Brandon and Haley Hopkins, Fred and Jeannie Huff, and Ron Hungerford. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, behold our nation and our leaders, and protect our armed forces, taking them all under your care and blessing. Give guidance and wisdom to our leaders at every level of government. Embolden and empower those who serve us in our community, including our police, our firefighters, and healthcare workers. And guard and protect those who serve us in the military, including Allison Blake, Luke Whitman, James Virgi, Joseph Schaefer, Matt Weiss, and Ethan Rick. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, give us success and prosper the work that you give to each of us to do, the work in our individual lives and also the tasks that you give to us as a congregation. Bless our school and the work that we do among youth and children and families. Be with our Grief Share ministry and also with our Ladies League, Altar Guild, and LWML, our Men's Network, and Lutheran Layman's League. Prosper the work that you give us to do. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Visit us in your compassion, O Lord. Deliver the sick from their infirmity, the troubled from their afflictions, the grieving from their sorrow, and the dying from their fear. We especially lift before you this day Amanda Clark, Amy Manti, Andrea Nyston, Ava Sandman, Barbara Mall, Barb Rogers, Connie Schwanger, Dave Knuth, Dave Radke, David Castoni, Don Jeske, Faith Tim, Fernie Rance, Jenny Hunt, Ken Virgi, Louise Winter, Louis Nuchterlein, Margaret Gerber, Miro Versick, Nancy Duke, Nathan Gerken, Norma Priebe, and Susan Jackemeyer. We also lift before you Ann Roush, Austin Arndt, Brian Bailey, Kate Reed, Chris Watson, Chris Gerlach, Christian Myers, Aaron Sage, Grant Plath, Jackie Klepper, Jenna Vine, John Trotsky, Joe Lotka, Carol Searing, Kelsey Bryant, Liam Pugh, Lisa Daring, Lynn Beasley, Nancy Gerald, Nathan Tim, Nathan and his family, Robert White, Ron Saveda, Tamara Ball, Sherry Orchard, and Veronica Wilkinson. May all who cry to you receive grace according to your will, and especially give them strength of faith and patience in perseverance. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Mercifully, merciful Lord, you have made us glad to enter into your presence to hear the good news of our Savior and receive your gifts. Preserve your church against all her enemies, and lead us to walk in your ways and to follow your paths, that when Jesus returns in his glory, we may welcome him with glad hosannas. We pray all of this through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father,
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us.
The Lord be with you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen.